That's our prayer this morning, is to just be a living sanctuary. Holy and acceptable. Some of us have been through the fire. Been dry. Some of us are going through the fire. Amen?
Amen.
Some of us are going through the fire. Some of us will be going through the fire. But you know, you have to go through the fire.
Yes.
Scripture teaches that. You have to go through the fire. In order to be bread that people can eat, you know, the bread has to be, if you take bread and mix it, flour and wheat, and you go through that process. Pastor Watts has talked about this many times. He makes homemade bread at home. Man, it is good. You want some good bread? Stop by his house when he's making it. Of course, you got to call and find out when he's making it. But it's good when he's making it. But he takes that flour and he mixes water with it and the yeast and it pounds it. I mean, that's part of the process, too. Pounds it. That hurts. Doesn't it? You know, when it starts to rise, you got to pound it back down. Sometimes we get too proud. We got to be pounded back down. I haven't even read the scripture yet. My. Sometimes we've got to get pounded back down. We get puffed up. And that pounding comes. That hurts. Doesn't it?
Yeah.
Those trials come. That hurts. But then, you know, you get it just right. And that bread, that gooey mess gets just right. And it's ready to do what? Go into the freezer, right? For people to eat off that gooey mess, right? Goes into the freezer. No. It doesn't go in the freezer. Where does it go? Into the fire. Don't you love going into the fire? Do you love going into the heat? Nah, I've been in some of your homes. Okay, in the summertime. I've been in some of your homes. Y'all don't like heat. I've been in some of your homes. You keep your houses at 63 degrees. I know you don't like heat. Okay? I've been in some of your homes. I need a winter coat to stay in your home and visit with y'all. Okay? Y'all don't like heat. Now see, places I grew up in, there wasn't air conditioning in the house. And when I would go visit my grandmother Watts and stay and work construction, I lived on the third floor with no air conditioning. You know, you get home from working construction and it's 110 outside with 150% humidity. Okay? You go home and you take a shower on that third floor, and you get out of the shower and you dry off, and you just as wet as you were in the shower after you dried off, and your clothes are sticking to you. Isn't that wonderful? Y'all don't like the heat, okay? People today got it easy with their air conditioning. Don't we? You know, grandfather waited until all the grandkids stopped living at his house to put air conditioning in his house. Isn't that true? I mean, he then put air conditioning in all three floors, and I'm going, really? Come on. But we go through the fire to be what? Pure, holy, tried, and true. To be that sanctuary. To come to that place of worship.
Amen.
To be a holy sacrifice, a living sacrifice that's pure and holy. See, that's what we've been talking about for a month now. It's worship. Sacrifice. Where is your sacrifice of praise? That's the question today. You see, what we're going to do today, what I'm going to attempt to do today, and where I believe the Lord is leading us today, is to culminate everything we've talked about through the month of July and talk about a story that we've talked about before, I've preached on before, but with a twist. Okay? So, you know, sometimes you get a tea with a twist in it. Well, today you get a sermon with a twist. All right? There are going to be some things that we've repeated that we're going to be repeated, but you're going to get a twist today. Because I believe the Lord wants to pick this story. And you know, sometimes we read scripture, and sometimes we read the same scripture, but we're at a different level. And I think we're at a different level today. And there are going to be some things that might be hard for some of us to hear because they were hard for me to deal with this week. But I believe the Lord wants us at a different level as a congregation, as a people, as individuals. So I think we have a twist today, all right? And hopefully you don't twist away from the Lord and what he might be saying to you. Hopefully today you twist toward him. Because I believe he wants to take us to a different level. I believe he wants to raise us up to a different level. Okay? So if you're listening today, if you're attentive today, if we are attentive today, I believe that there can be some real meeting together of spirit and water. You remember those? Remember that message? Took 2 weeks to get through. If you don't remember it, you need to go online and review it. Okay? Because I believe that we got some dry places that we need to deal with. I believe today that if we're listening to what God wants to say to us today, I believe that we can leave Hagar and Ishmael goodbye. I believe we can. And we can go to a different level of worship. And a different level in our relationship with God. Are you ready? You ready? Now, it may be hard. The fire may be there. Maybe a little pounding today. All right? You okay with that? Doesn't matter. We're going to do it anyhow. All right? Genesis chapter 22, verse 5. There's a saying that goes, long scripture, short sermon. Short scripture. Can you finish it? Ha ha ha. I'm going to ask you to stand as we read the scripture this morning. I won't ask you to stand again until we get ready for the altar call. Unless the Spirit has you stand during the message. Then if the Spirit has you stand during the message, y'all better stand. Okay? Because that's not me asking you to stand. All right? Abraham said unto his young men, bide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship and come again to you. I and the lad will go where? will go yonder and worship and come again to you. Let us pray. Father, we love your word. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you, Lord, for I thank you for this body of believers. I thank you, Lord, for this church, this building, where you have placed us in this city. And I thank you that you are raising a city within the city. Help us this morning to hear from your throne, that we not follow man's agenda, we follow your will, your perfect will for our lives today. Spirit, have your way. Speak to hearts, challenge us, break us, but remake us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. We've been on this journey of worship. We started in Romans with three simple words. I don't know. Remember that? I don't know. That's where it all starts. That's where this journey all starts. If you want to go into a deeper relationship, if you want to go into a deeper relationship with God, if you want to go to a deeper level of worship, you have to come to a place of admitting to God, I know not. I don't know how to worship. I don't know how to do this thing. I don't know. And when you get there, the Spirit then has the ability and the freedom to step in and take you to that place. But until you admit, and until you say, I don't know, I know not, you're sitting on the throne. At least that's what we discovered. We had to come to a place of surrendering. And we started there with, I don't know. And hopefully you've thought about that since that message. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know who holds. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but I know who holds tomorrow. Yeah. I don't know where my life is going to be in the next 30 seconds, but I know who holds my life for the next 30 seconds. If you don't know who holds your life for the next 30 seconds, then you don't need to wait till we sing just as I am. You need to get to the altar now. And you need to ask Jesus to come into your life right this moment. Because you are not guaranteed the next 30 seconds. You need to come to a place of, I don't know. I don't know where I'm going when I die. Well, if you can't answer that question, you definitely need to ask Jesus into your life. Because you can know today where you're going when you die. You can start living eternity today, right now, with the eternal hope of knowing I'm going to heaven, I'm living with God, I'm walking as His child today. I have the ability to walk, as we said Wednesday night, to walk into the Holy of Holies and bow before a majestic, awesome, powerful, just God, who also is loving, merciful, and gracious. Both at the same time. Oh, if you weren't here Wednesday night, we had a great time of discussion. And by the way, if you have an account on Right Now Media, you got an email late last night of that discussion. Late last night. Okay? We're back in the recording. Of course, I wasn't dressed very nice, so you just have to deal with that. But you got an email account. You got an email with that. Some of you, by the way, are having trouble getting on to Right Now Media. If you're still having trouble, let me know. We'll try to figure it out. Okay? Commercial aside. I don't know. From there, we went to Luke. We found out the devils don't like dry places. We talked about water and the Spirit. And remember, we jumped around in a lot of Scripture, and we talked about how Jesus was standing up at the end of the feast, and he said to them, "If any man thirst, let him come unto me." Are you thirsty this morning? God seeketh. God seeks those that will worship him. Are you seeking? Are you ready to worship? Because God is going up through the aisles, in and out of the rows, seeking those that will worship. If any man thirst, if any man thirst, if any man thirst, let him come in. Are you thirsty this morning? Jesus is ready. If any man thirst, devils don't like dry places. And we talked about the water and the spirit and the combination that comes together with water and spirit. And we walked up throughout scripture, and out of your bellies comes that water, that flowing water, that spirit that comes out of you, that water that comes there that God puts down inside of you. When you have that relationship and worship comes out of you. And when you start worshiping the Lord, the waves, it starts to rain. The Spirit starts to meet. And you start to give Christ something to sit on and start worshiping. And the worship intensifies. And it doesn't matter where you are. You can be riding in your car. It doesn't matter where you are. When you start praising God, the Spirit, it starts to rain in your life. And the Spirit meets you there. And worship starts. You start to go to different places in the Spirit. And the devil's got to go. When you start praising God, all hell starts to tremble. Bless the Lord. That's exciting, Sue. Isn't that exciting? Yeah. You want to make the gates of hell tremble? Start praising God. You know, I've said this before. When Paul and Silas were down under the jail and they started praising God, you know, the earthquake that took place there, everybody says that was, you know, some people say that was to get them out. That wasn't to get them out, because they could have left. But they didn't leave. They stayed right there. Didn't they? The jailer was ready to kill himself because he thought everybody had escaped. And it wasn't just Paul and Silas that were set free. The scripture says all of the cells were opened up. All of the chains fell off. All of the prisoners were set free. And yet all of them stayed there having church. They were all still there. And the jailer was about to kill himself. And Paul says, "Whoa, wait a minute, we're all still here. You want to join us?" And it wasn't there to set them free. It was there because that all took place not to set them free, but because God was getting in where the praise was. Water and spirit were coming together there in the bottom of that jail. And two things happened. The devils had to get out quickly, and the Spirit had to come in. And that's what caused the earthquake, I believe. Don't you? And it shook the foundations of that building, Fred. Now that's a little religious imagination, okay? It's religious imagination. Fred's laughing at me back there. That's a little religious imagination. Think about it. That's exciting. All right. Any man thirst, Spirit rides on the water. Last couple of weeks we were in Hebrews, bringing the sacrifice of praise, looking at the obstetrics of praise, the pediatrics of praise, and the bar mitzvah of praise, the obstetrics. Try to say that early in the morning. The obstetrics. You know it. It's up there. I've said it the last 2 weeks, and I can't say it this morning. Okay? It's up there. We are a royal priesthood, and we come into His presence. We need to come into His presence with something in our hands. Come into His presence bringing God something. And so we bring Him a sacrifice of praise, a living praise from the fruit of our lips. A place where as a well-trained, well-disciplined soldier of Christ, we will bless the Lord at all times. When it's hot, when it hurts, when we're in trouble, we will bless the Lord at all times. When life is good, when life is down, when life is sideways, when life is up, when life is flipped upside down, I will bless the Lord at all times out of my lips. Why? Because God is a speaking God. And I am a well-trained, well-disciplined priest of God. And you know what? If you are a believer, so are you. That's what Scripture says. We are a royal priesthood. A royal priesthood. We're not just a priesthood. We are a royal priesthood. And we should be bringing something to God. Then we talk about the pediatrics of praise. That thing that you believed God for, it has been birthed. That thing that you believed God, that you've been praying for, Jesus. And when you talk about it in the pediatrics of praise, Jesus became the reality of all the shadows of the Old Testament sacrifice. So there was no more need for the goats to be brought into the temple of praise. There was no more need for the bulls and the pigeons to be brought in to be sacrificed. But we are to just bring him a sacrifice of praise. Bring him in a good hallelujah. Bring him in a good praise the Lord. Not one of these hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. No, what'll they think of me if I do that? Praise the Lord! Sorry, Caleb, I had to yell. Alright? Praise the Lord. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving, and I will enter his courts with praise. Out of my lips. Pediatrics. Then we talked about the bar mitzvah of praise, and that's the rite of passage, moving through the veil into the Holy of Holies. And we talked about that last week, about coming to that place where we talked about the story of Abraham, and it's there in Genesis 21, coming to that place where he messed up. God had given him the promise of Isaac and becoming a good nation and the father of many nations, and he had messed up, and he'd come to this place, and he'd gotten Hagar and Ishmael, and they had grown up, and now he's got Isaac, and Ishmael's mocking Isaac, and we got a lot of principles, but the bottom line came down to the place where he comes to the bar mitzvah of praise, where he talks about the sacrifice, where he kisses Hagar goodbye, kisses Ishmael goodbye. He deals with his mistake. I love them, but I love him more. I want to stay with them. I want to be with them. I want to see my son grow up, but I'm moving toward him. Today, I want to take it a little bit further. I want us to talk about the next story in Abraham's life, because as dramatic as that story was in his life, as meaningful as this was in his life, the next story in his family life must have been a huge hit. Must have been awful. A huge test of his faith. I mean, think about it. Take your son, your only son. I mean, that right there is something else. Take your only son, the son of promise, and go to a place that I'll show you. Now that part of Scripture is nothing new to Abraham, is it? Go to a place that I'll show you. God's told him that before. I mean, at the beginning, pack up your family. Go to a land that I'll show you. I want you to leave your father, leave everything, and go to a land that I'm going to show you. That's nothing new. Abraham's done that. Abraham's been obedient to that. So that part of the story, that ain't hard for him. I can do that. No big deal. But the next part is where it gets rough. I want you to take your son, Isaac, your only son, Isaac, the son of promise, the son you waited so long for, the son that you had with Sarah, the one that you had to work so hard to get me off the hook with. Take him to this place. And Abraham, I want you to sacrifice him to me. What? Now, I don't know about you, but there would have been some arguing from me. Actually, I do know about some of you. Because there would have been arguing from some of you too. The Lord and I would have had some discussion. What do you mean? Do you realize how long I've waited for him? Now he's 20. I'm 120. Do you understand this, God? There's no way Sarah can have another one of these kids. There's no way I want to go through all that mess again. All that grief with her again. You want me to do what? How in the world am I going to get him to agree to this, God? Are you sure about this? Do you think any of you might have that discussion? Some of you went to sleep, didn't you? However, what he does here is one of the reasons why he gets into the Hall of Fame of Faith, isn't it? Because there's none of that discussion there. If you read the story, he gets up, gathers the stuff, and he heads out. There's no discussion. He just does it. Okay, Lord, whatever you say, whatever you want, whatever you ask of me, not my will, but thine be. What? Do you see it, church? Do you see what it takes to get to the place of worship? Do you see what it takes to get to the place where God is? Do you see what it takes to get to the place where you can move into the Holy of Holies? Not my will, but thine be done. Not my comfort, not my ease, not my will, but thine be done. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. I'll serve where you want me to serve. I'll do what you want. Do you see what Abraham did here? It was total surrender to the Lord's will. I'll give up what you want, Lord. I'm not holding on to that website anymore. I'm not holding to that sexual immorality anymore. I'm not holding to that bitterness anymore. I'm not holding to that complacency anymore. I'll go where you're calling me. I'm not holding to that anxiety anymore. I'm not holding to that anger anymore. I'm not holding to my selfish desires. at home. I don't treat my wife the way I should. I'm not loving to my children. I'm not loving to my wife. I'm not loving to my husband. I'm not obedient to my parents. I'm playing around with lesbianism. I'm playing around with homosexuality. I'm playing around with extramarital affairs. I'm playing around with drugs. I'm playing around with alcohol. I'm playing around with porn on the internet. I'm playing around with witchcraft. I'm playing around with lying. I'm playing around with rebellion. If you want to go yonder and worship, church, you have to go where the Lord tells you to go. That means that you have to be willing to surrender and leave those things behind. Not my will, but thine be done. Oh, see, in this story, a lot of times we we'll deal with it here in just a minute, but we do a lot of typology of this story between Isaac and Jesus. But there's one step here in motive, I think, between Abraham and the Garden of Gethsemane. Abraham packed it up and followed Christ, or followed God. And says, okay, your will. Jesus, in the garden, the night he was betrayed, not my will, but thine be done. Church, if we want to get to where God is, if we want to worship at a deeper level, if we want a deeper relationship with him, then we've got to start cleaning house. And we've got to say, not my will, but thine be done. Because it's not about me, it's all about him. That means we've got to start looking at some of the issues that we're dealing with individually as well as corporately, that we've been hiding in the closet, and it's time to expose it. Because we got some devils in dry places. And it's time to apply the water of the Spirit and chase them out. Boy, y'all got quiet. That means it's hitting home. That's a good thing. Okay? Now, we've been through this story before. Y'all remember it. He packed three things. He packed the wood, knife, and the fire. Y'all remember that? The wood represented that it was dry. The things you've been through, that's your testimony, that's your witness, that's your victory, that's your thankfulness, that's your thanksgiving, that gets you through the gates, that gets you onto the courts, that gets you to the brazen altar, that he has brought me through that dark time. I've come a long way. I see the place. I see where I'm to go. I have my wood. He provided the money needed to pay that bill. He provided healing for my cancer. He gave me strength today. Years ago, I kissed that relationship with unforgiveness goodbye, and now I have the wood to show for it. I'm ready to take it to the altar and start the fire. I'm ready to burn it up as a sacrifice of praise. I'm ready to offer it up this morning. You just don't know what I've been through, but here's my wood to show what I've been through. Let me tell you this morning about my testimony. Let me tell you, when things were the darkest, that's when he shined his marvelous light onto my life. I called out to him, and he came at my darkest time. And here's my wood to show what he did for me. And I'm ready to offer it up as a part of my sacrifice. I'm ready to give it to the Lord as part of my worship this morning. I'm ready to speak out my testimony. I'm ready that when I get into His presence, to take the fire of the Spirit and light this stuff up. I've been traveling 3 days. I've been with the servants. And I've left it all behind. I've been obedient. He has shown me the place. And now I'm ready with my wood. Listen, you can have my shoes. You can have my socks. You can have the shirt on my back. But you can't have my wood. It's my testimony. The day He saved me, I was sinking deep in sin, from far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me. Now safe am I. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. I want to tell you this morning, that's my wood, baby. And I'm bringing it in for the sacrifice of praise. You got some wood this morning? If you've got some wood this morning, then you can bring in to the sacrifice of praise. We can burn it up. We can go on in. We can bring the testimony. We can bring the thankfulness. We can come in to through the gates with some thankfulness this morning. Are you thankful this morning? Do you have some thanks this morning? Do you have some thanks this morning? Are you thankful this morning? Are you thankful to God this morning? Do you have some wood this morning? Has He brought you through something this morning? Has He picked you up this morning? Has He given you something to be thankful for this morning? I'll bet He has. And I'll bet you don't have to think very hard about it. I'll bet you can just think a little bit and you'll have some wood this morning. That's the good part. That's the easy part. Because we all can have some wood. Right? We all can. Oh, I'm thankful He got me out of bed this morning. My bones may have creaked. They may have been sore. It may have hurt a little bit. But I'm thankful that my feet hit the floor. Huh? Come on. Oh, I'm thankful for the roof over my head. Because I could be living out on the streets. But even if I was living out on the streets, I'm thankful for the breath I've got in my body. Oh, I'm thankful for the piece of toast that I ate this morning and the eyeball jelly. Now some of you cringe, but it's cherry jam, alright, that my wife made for me. We just call it eyeball jelly, alright? That's what we've always called it. That's what my grandmother called it. That's what we call it. It just looks like little eyeballs floating around in red jelly. It's just cherry jam, alright? That's all it is. But I'm thankful for the toast in my wife's eyeball jelly. It's really good. Y'all ought to try it. Don't cringe until you try it. Okay? It's really good. And you just kind of suck in my balls down. You know? Can't wait till that hits the internet. I'm thankful for the food that He put on my table. I'm thankful that my truck started this morning so that my wife could have the car to go home after church so that I could stay for the meeting.
Amen.
I'm thankful for the chair that you're sitting in. I'm thankful that y'all are here this morning. Oh, we got some wood that we can go on in and praise the Lord. That's the easy part. The next thing that He had was the knife. Now, if you remember, the knife was along to cut out those things that weren't quite dead yet. there are some things that we need to cut out. This is where it gets tough, because if you come in here and have, if you, if, because we like to come in here and have the warm fuzzies, don't we? We don't like to think of things that we need to cut out of our lives. However, if we're going yonder to worship, there are things that we need to cut out. And there are things corporately that we need to cut out. And there are things personally that we need to cut out. And as I've been praying, and I'm going to stick pretty close to my notes and try not to look around this morning. Although I may look around some, but I'm going to stick pretty close to my notes as I go through this. As I've been praying and studying for this morning, there have been some thoughts that have come to mind. And one of them is, I have noticed in churches and in our church that we like to be like Mary. Do you remember Mary? And I'm not talking about Mary, our Mary. I'm talking about Mary in the Bible. Mary and Martha. And the story of Mary and Martha, Jesus was there. Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus listening. Martha was in the kitchen. What was she doing?
Preparing,
working, getting mad, wasn't she? She was working, but she was getting mad. She had an attitude. Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus listening, right? And I've noticed that in churches today, we like to be like Mary. Know what I mean? They were sitting there, and finally Martha had had enough and said, Jesus, you tell Mary to get in here and help me. I've seen that in our house. She's getting upset. But you know, there was another time when Jesus was back in their house, and both ladies were working preparing the meal. You see, there is a time to sit at the feet of Jesus, and there is a time to work in the kitchen. There is a time to be Mary, and there is a time to be Martha. Church, we have picked up an attitude of it's someone else's job. Leadership can take care of that. Leave it there long enough, Pastor Rob will take care of it. Oh, y'all got quiet again. Well, I want you to know something. Over the past couple of weeks, I've developed a very negative attitude. Now I'm getting personal. Me. I've developed a very negative attitude. And this negative attitude is, well, if they don't care, why should I? You see, if we're going to grow, if we're going to the next level, if we're going to be all that we can be, it's time for us to learn the difference of Mary and Martha. It's time for us to take ownership, all of us, to take ownership of the church. That means that if you see something that needs to be done, do it. That's taking ownership. So if you walk in the kitchen and there's dishes that have been washed and sitting on the counter and they're dry, put them away. If you don't know where they go, look around and find a place. If they're not in the right place, that's okay. Someone will come behind you and put them in the right place. Maybe. And if not, they'll find it, use it, and wash it, and someone else will put it in the wrong place too. And that's okay too. Dishes need away. Put them away. If the trash is full, empty it. One of the things that is just very irritating is to walk out that door and see balanced coffee cups on a full trash can. And there's still coffee in the coffee cup. Really? How long does it take to pull the trash bag up, close the bag, and walk it not to the back door, but on out to the dumpster? All right. I came back from teen week, and there was a trash bag. I came in on a Sunday, And I'll tell you what, if some church folk had been here, they would have heard me real negative, because I was real negative that Sunday morning. And I put on my happy face when church folks started walking in. But I walked in and there was a trash bag sitting by the back door. That trash bag had been sitting there for 2 weeks, waiting for somebody to take it to the dumpster. I took it to the dumpster. When I lifted it up, there was a colony of ants underneath of it. Swept up the colony of ants, and we all shake our heads. Oh my goodness, why didn't someone take that out? Yeah, well, you know, how many people walk by it in 2 weeks' time? That's my point. If you're in the bathroom and you see that the stall doesn't have any toilet paper, walk down the hall to the brown metal door that is on the right-hand side. It's got two furnaces in it. It's loaded with paper towels and toilet paper. Pick up a couple rolls, bring it back to the stall, put it in the stall. Don't wait for someone else to do it. You do it. That's taking ownership. It's time for us to take ownership. If you see chairs that are out of place, put them in place. There are two fellas that show up here every Sunday. This setup doesn't just happen. There are two fellas that come here, and they've been coming here for around 3 years at 8:30 every Sunday morning to set this up for y'all. You know, it would go a whole lot faster if some more would come and help. Take ownership. It's time for us to stop relying on someone else to do the job that we can do. It's time for us to take ownership. If the floors need swept, get the sweeper and sweep it. Don't wait. Paper needs picked up, pick it up. If water needs turned off, turn it off. If the nursery needs someone in there, go serve. If a child is running wild, if Michael's running wild through the church, grab him. I'm his grandfather and I can say that. Grab him gently. But stop them and explain to them the respect of the building.
Amen.
And talk to them. I mean, when we dedicate children, we bring them to the altar. And one of the questions we ask the congregation is will you accept the responsibility of help raising this child in a godly way?
Amen.
And all of you stand. Shouldn't we be doing that then?
Yeah.
That's taking ownership. That's taking ownership. Church, you see, this attitude of it's someone else's responsibility, it's leadership's responsibility, someone else will do it, someone else, that's something that's got to be cut out. It's time for us to take ownership. Yes, the building does not make the church. We are the church. People are the church. But God has blessed us with the building, and we are responsible for the building. Now, if we don't want that responsibility, let's sell it. Well, you all got real quiet then. I mean, that's the other option, isn't it? Let's deal with this attitude. There's a time to be merry and listen. There is. Lord has blessed us with some wonderful teachers here in this church. And there are some rich opportunities for spiritual growth in this church. From youth to Sunday school to the preaching of the word, there are some rich times to be married. There's a time to be Mary and worship, but then there is a time to be Martha. And we need to cut out the complacency. And we need to cut out the attitude it's someone else's job. No, it's our job. It's our job. It's someone else's job to give money and to give their time. No, it's our job. It's someone else's job to show up for work days. No, it's our job. It's someone else's job to serve as a teacher's aide. No, it's our job. You get the idea? Now, personally, that's corporately, personally. In order for us to get to the next level of worship, we have to cut out the bitterness that we're holding on to. If you're holding on to bitterness, you've got to cut it out. We've got to cut out the gossip. We've got to cut out the anger. We've got to cut out the resentment. We've got to cut out the immorality. We've got to cut out the playing church and start being the church. We have to start being holy when we get online. That includes what we do and what we say on Facebook. Not only publicly, but also in private messaging. You see, in going yonder, you are coming into the presence of a holy God, and He deserves our best. He deserves reverence, and He deserves a holy praise. That means that we need to cut things out. That means that we need to take a hard look at our lives and stop playing around. Many today are just playing Christians. We put Christianity on Sunday and take it off when we get in the car and leave church. There is no holiness. But we want the blessing of the Lord. We want the power of the Lord. We want the healing of the Lord. We want all the promises of the Lord. We want to be able to climb up in His lap and call Him Daddy. We want the cosmic Santa Claus. We want the bread. We want the freedom. We want all the perks without the work. And we want it now. Well, that's not what the Bible teaches. There is a cutting that needs to take place in our lives, and that cutting hurts. That cutting takes time. It may take several times of cutting. It may take several cuts. But if you want to go yonder, if you want to be a living sacrifice, if you want to worship, if you want to move into the Holy of Holies, if you want to have the Spirit be powerful in your life, then there has to be a cutting that takes place in your life. You have to come to a place of saying, I know not. I'm tired of being in dry places. I need you, Jesus, and I want surrender right now. I come right now. Cut it out. I surrender my porn addiction. I surrender my bitterness. I surrender my anger. I surrender my rebellion. I surrender my complacency. I surrender my mouth. I surrender my attitude. I surrender my sexual immorality. I surrender my drug addiction. I surrender my alcohol. I surrender my mind. Come and cut it out right now. I bring the sacrifice to you. Well, then we have the fire. And I'm coming down to the end. The fire will be able to come and join in our worship. The fire is the Holy Spirit. This is where you'll be able to tell the devil, you should have killed me when you had a chance. But since you didn't, the Spirit and I are going to worship. The Spirit and I have some business to do with the Lord. And you are going to be defeated. You are not going to be defeated. You are defeated. And by the way, devil, do you remember that herd of pigs that that Jesus cast you into? What happened when Jesus cast the legion into them? Do you remember the story? They ran into the sea and drowned. You see, when you mix the water and the Spirit, the devil can't swim. Because when you start worshiping, when you cut out the things that God wants cut out, when you get your wood, when you surrender and go where He tells you, when you take the knife, the Spirit comes and starts to ride on the wave of your worship, and the devil starts to run. But look what the Spirit does. The Spirit will come and provide exactly what is needed. The encouragement, the healing, the strength to face that person that needs your forgiveness. The strength to face the person that you need to go and ask for forgiveness. The strength to deal with that porn addiction. The strength to deal with that sexual immorality. The strength to deal with complacency. The strength to grow up and be the man and woman that God wants you to be. And the fire of the Spirit will come and consume the dry wood. And will come and take what you are cutting out. And will come and take your sacrifice of praise and give it to God. And God will provide what you need as you bring the sacrifice. From the outer court to the inner court and on into the Holy of Holies. And you will worship Him in spirit and in truth. You will worship Him as you were created to worship Him. The water and the Spirit will meet, and you will discover the majesty of God. And you will discover the God of creation. And you will discover the God who saves, and the God who heals, and the God who blesses, and the God who loves, and the God who shows mercy, and the God who is just, and the God who is the great I Am. So the question is, will you go yonder? Because church, I got my wood. My knife, and I'm ready for the Spirit to burn up my sacrifice of praise this morning. Amen. Because I know God, and I don't want any dry places. I want the Spirit to rain down in this place as we cut out things that the Lord wants gone. Ask for me.